该晒唔该晒，可以开麦啊！早晨。
All right, good morning, members. This morning, we now call to order the Bills Committee on Inland Revenue Profits Tax Exemption for Funds Amendment Bill 2018. This is the second meeting. We have a quorum. Let us invite the officials into the room.
Good 早晨啊，各位同事嘅早。
Good morning, good morning, everybody.
好啦，各位
Good morning to the government officials.Thank you very much for coming at 8:30 for the meeting. This is the second meeting of the Bills Committee. I think many of your colleagues are now helping out at the Asian Financial Forum. Thank you very much for coming for our meeting starting at 8:30. Last time, we discussed the policy direction of the bill as well as.Conducted a clause-by-clause study of the bill. We have invited members of the public to give their comments on the bill. And as at the 15th of January, the Secretariat has received 11 submissions. And all of them came from professional bodies and practitioners of the trade. The documentshave been included in 447, 1819, and also 464, 1819, and have been circulated among members for reference. By and large, the 11 submissions give support to this bill, though they have various different views in respect of particular clauses. If I may ask the administration to give a general response to the 11 submissions. The administration has already tabled a written reply which has not been numbered.I received the paper last evening at about 5:30, and I thank the administration for giving me this response within a very short notice. Yes, the secretary, as said by the chairman, with regard to the 11 submissions, generally they do support the bill and also the purpose and content of the bill. Of course, they have also given someof their own opinions, and we've noticed that some of the views are not directly related to the bill, but they are the issues that are close to the hearts of the trade, and therefore they raise them as well. To facilitate the study of the bill, it's better to follow the order of the bill in respect of the points, and I'll ask Ms. Cheng,to highlight the main points in respect of the bill. Yes, the Assistant Secretary. Thank you. If I may ask members to refer to the paper. The paper is not too long. It's just 6 pages. And it follows the arrangement of the section number of the blue bill. So the AS, will you please introduce the paper? Thank you, Chairman. Good morning, members.In our reply, we stress once again that the purpose of the bill is to address the concerns of the EU over the ring-fencing features of Hong Kong's tax regime for offshore privately offered funds. It seems that the microphone is not working. Is it getting through now? Yes, thank you. My apologies.The purpose of the bill is to address the concerns of the European Union over the ring-fencing features of Hong Kong's tax regimes for offshore privately offered funds, and to create a level playing field for both onshore and offshore funds operating in Hong Kong. We've mentioned that in our first briefing. Since we've already got an arrangement suitable for offshore funds and also familiar with the trade, we want to maintain all the existing arrangements as far as possible, and therefore in the proposed sections 20AN to 20AY and Schedule 15C, D and 16C are the same largely modeled on existing provisions relating to the tax treatment for offshore funds and open-ended fund companies under the IRO. As said by Mrs. Soon, we've noted that the trade generally supports the bill. The purpose is to make sure that if the funds are in compliance with certain conditions, regardless of their structure and their size or purpose, they have the same treatment. We have no intention to impose any restrictions. Whether it's a unit trust, or whether it's a corporation, or whether it is a limited partnership, the funds can enjoy the same exemptions. In the submissions, we've also noted that apart from supporting the major direction of the bill, there are various technical opinions or comments. In paragraphs 5 to 17, we try to address those technical comments. As said by the chairman, we have arranged our reply according to the order of the clauses in the bill. In drawing up the blue bill in April, May last year, we consulted the trade. In response to their views, the tax exemption arrangements applicable to funds have been picked out and separated in a particular chapter. As for existing arrangements not suitable, not applicable to the funds, we retain them. As for specific submissions and cases, the IRD will base on the circumstances of each case, for example, the composition of fund, investment purpose, past and obligations of the managers, will consider whether exemption can be given in the light of all these. As for the specific arrangements, first is about the commencement of the bill. As stated in the bill, it will come into operation on the 1st of April 2019 if an arrangement can fulfill the requirements set out in the bill. That arrangement can enjoy the profits tax exemption according to 20A1 to AY. In fact, existing arrangements will continue. In other words, if it is an offshore fund, it will continue to enjoy the provisions under 20A1. If it is an open fund corporation, then it is 20AH. If it is for public offer funds, 26A1A. As for the second group of opinions, they are related to a definition of fund under 20AM. According to the bill, arrangements fulfilling the definition of fund under 20AM and meeting relevant conditions would be eligible for profits tax exemption under 20AN. In defining the fund, in making the definition, we have consulted and we have taken on board some of the views given. And the proposal can cover all the bona fide funds in operation, including pension funds. With regard to pension funds, our understanding is most of the pension funds, both onshore and offshore, are publicly offered funds. As I said earlier, if it is a publicly ordered fund, it can enjoy profits tax exemption under 26A1A. There is no need to rely on 20AN. There are other views in respect of 20AM5 about its purpose. Now, this is to exclude investment arrangements restricted to a group of companies and prevent turning taxable remuneration benefits of employees into tax-exempted income through a fund structure such as share option scheme, share award schemes, profit sharing plan, post-employment benefit arrangement, and termination benefit arrangement. There are views inquiring the fund of one situation. According to Cap 1, plural includes the singular. Therefore, participating persons in proposed Section 20AM 2 can be read as a participating person. Reading this together with the proposed Section 20AM 3A, and subject to meeting the relevant conditions, an arrangement may qualify for tax exemption as a fund, even though it has one investor at a certain point in time during the year of assessment.
In relation to 20AM, bracket 6 and 7, in our first meeting, we did discuss these proposed sections. We want to make sure that a fund itself should not be directly undertaking any trading or business activities for general commercial or industrial purposes. A business undertaking would include one that directly engages in a commercial or an industrial activity, including but not limited to those mentioned in the proposed Section 20AM bracket 7. These are the responses to Section 20AM. Next, I'd like to move on to Section 20AN and Section 20AO on tax exemption for funds and for special purpose entity. There are many comments here in relation to incidental transactions. Incidental transactions are defined as transactions incidental to the carrying out of qualifying transactions. And so the incidental transactions defined under the Section 20AN2B are actually the same as those in the existing Section 20AC bracket 1 bracket B. These arrangements for tax treatment are also much like the existing sections. The list of qualifying assets is set up in the proposed Schedule 16C. And this covers assets currently qualified for tax exemption for offshore funds and open-ended fund companies. So you can see that these are pretty much the same as the existing sections. Next, moving on to special purpose entity, SPE. Under the proposed Section 20A04, the definition is the same as the current Section 20AC8 bracket 2. 20AC8 bracket 2 was introduced in 2015 due to private funds and maybe having to invest in private companies through investment vehicles. We consider it not appropriate to extend the scope of profits tax exemption for an SPE at this juncture. There are some comments on the tax arrangements for relaxing to engage in fund investment activities. So in today's number 51 of the RLD Departmental Interpretation and Practice Notes, it is already stated very clearly that as long as these transactions as long as they sell its investment through an initial public offering, then it will continue to be eligible for profits tax exemption in respect of the divestment if the exemption conditions remain satisfied. The next comments relate to 20AP and 20AQ on requirements for investment in private companies. 20AP and 20AQ list out three requirements, which are immovable property test, holding period test, and short-term asset test. Actually, two of the tests are not new. we have already used immovable property test and short-term asset test in OFCs. These have already been incorporated in the tax exemption regime. We believe that if the holding period test is less than 2 years, and the fund also has a controlling stake in the invested private company concerned, then the test is applicable to investments. But we believe that this should not be limited to Hong Kong assets, and this is the same provision for OFCs. For Section 20AR on tax treatment of co-investment of partner funds of the Innovation and Technology Venture Fund Scheme, we have retained in the bill the same tax treatment for such co-investment. The bill does not prevent the use of an SPE in a co-investment by a partner fund of the ITVF scheme. A partner fund, subject to meeting the relevant conditions, may enjoy tax exemption for the co-investment without the need to meet the three tests under the proposed sections 20AP and 20AQ. Another set of questions are in relation to Section 20AS on circumstances whereby profits tax exemption does not apply to OFCs. We did discuss this in our first meeting. Profits of an OFC or of other funds arising from direct trading or direct business undertaking should be chargeable to profits tax. Therefore, 20AS is the same as set out in the current Section 20AH7, and that will also not affect the eligibility for profits tax exemption in other qualified transactions. Moving on to loss sustained by funds and OFCs and the anti-round-tripping provisions. This is under Sections 20AU, 20AV, 20AX, and 20AY. We have retained in the bill the same treatment for the setting off of losses by funds and OFCs. Loss sustained by a fund or an OFC in respect of its tax-exempted transactions would not be available for set off against any of its assessable profits for the year of assessment or any subsequent year of assessment. And we have retained in the bill the same anti-round-tripping provisions applicable to funds to prevent tax leakage. We have looked at drafting proposals and considered that the current drafting of the bill should be sufficiently clear to implement the tax exemption treatment. Thank you. Well, we only received these responses yesterday evening, so you may need some time to absorb all the information. Any questions from members? Well, let me ask the first question. After the first meeting, we received queries from the industry. A matter of concern is that I have now removed the tainting issue, that if they are qualifying income and part of it is not qualified income, then the qualifying part would still be able to enjoy tax exemption. So that's the basic principle. And there was a question on that if a company during operation is not already a fund anymore, that through direct trading is not a fund, does it mean that you cannot enjoy the tax exemption? They said no, there's a tainting provision. Does it mean that part of it could be used for profit and part of it could be used in investments, and maybe the investment part will be able to enjoy the exemption? Well, my understanding is that it is not possible. Can you try to elaborate further on this? this is already a an undertaking company already. Well, thank you, Chairman. Well, the first of all, it has to be defined as a fund. It must be a, if it is a direct business undertaking, then it does not qualify for our first definition because it is not a fund. And then, well, since it's not eligible already under the first requirement, then we do not need to be concerned with that. Well, yes, there is a new definition here, including open-ended funds and also arrangements. If you have a business agreement in which everyone invests together, this is actually not a entity, so can it be defined also as a fund? Well, we do have a legal definition for fund. The definition is very broad. Usually, it would include contractual arrangements, and it would also include under civil law judicial arrangements. Therefore, it could cover the circumstances raised by the chairman. Well, if this definition is so broad, then so for other, it doesn't state out the undertakings under the other arrangements because, well, unless they're actually already a business undertaking, are there any entities that do not actually are covered under this definition? Oh, Chairman. Well, we have to look at whether it is defined as a fund. Well, if it's a structure, if it's a partnership, or it could be a limited partnership, it can also be an OFC. It can also be a mutual corporation. So, there is actually no regulation on the legal form. Well, for the offshore part, you're still leaving part of it as offshore. So what kind of entities are you catering for? Why do you still need to sort of leave a tail in the for offshore funds to enjoy this exemption? Can you share with me the details? Well, 20AC states that once it becomes effective in April 1st, then it would include individuals such as those living abroad or a person paying tax who is not living in Hong Kong, is living abroad. Well, now I'd like to invite members to ask questions. Any questions? No, I don't have questions. Well, I don't have any other questions. Well, we do have a timetable for this bill. Well, we have already completed the scrutiny of this bill. So I'm going to report it to the House Committee on January 25th. Well, I have to say that I won't be in town on January 25th, but I would appoint someone to speak on my behalf. Well, I suggest the government, I hope that you would also take a look at the timetable to resume second reading in council meeting on February 20th of this year. If members would like to propose amendments, then you must raise these before February 11th of this year. Any other business? I would like to thank all members and the administration to work hard in scrutinizing the bill. Thank you. Meeting adjourned.